Hello and welcome to Smarter Tech. This is Nick, the EMF Guy Pinot, and I'm here with two guests today. I have here two attorneys that are working on what I consider to be an extremely important case that might, in the end, over a few years, change everything when it comes to cell phone safety in particular. Thanks so much for being here, gentlemen.
Good morning. Thank you.
And of course, I'm talking about Pedro Gregorio and Charles O'Brien. And please, gentlemen, if you can introduce yourselves quickly, talk about your background, and maybe end up talking about how you ended up working together on that case. I don't know exactly, what firm you come from and how this story basically transpired, but I think it will be a very important story because some people who follow my work are familiar with PhoneGate in France, and how this entire story unfolded, I'm not sure. And I think it will be a fascinating discussion. Maybe starting with you, Charles.
Sure. Charles O'Brien. I'm an environmental lawyer. I got my training at Vermont Law School. I was the first Canadian to go there. Also have a degree in law from Paris and two from McGill. So I've been doing environmental law since 1991. I've been doing class actions for about the past 10 years. Our case, the case that Pedro is assisting me with, he hasn't got his law degree yet, though I think he's a very good lawyer. He's actually mostly an engineer. But he does know now a great deal about the law. We've been doing EMF cases in one form or another. There's been three of them for me and two of them for Pedro for about a decade. Pedro's a friend of mine, a longstanding friend of mine, and I've always trusted him on the science. These cases are about the science more than anything else, and it's very complex. So I approached Pedro about 7 years ago to help me with another class action suit, just to make sure that I understood things properly and there were questions about EMF. And ever since that time, he's been a consultant in these files and an expert helping us out. So that's my story. Pedro, you want to talk?
Yeah, so full disclosure, I am not a lawyer. I don't pretend to be a lawyer.
Gotcha.
Never have
a lawyer. I pretend to be a lawyer.
Says, as Charles says, I'm mostly a mechanical engineer. Master's and bachelor's from McGill University many moons ago. And worked in many technology domains over the years, everything from robotics to space satellites to surgical devices, a whole lot of things passing through a career that had me working for probably 5 or 10 years directly in the cell phone industry, creating, inventing, and implementing technology pretty much in every modern cell phone, and as well in space systems, spending a decade building space systems, including microwave telecommunication systems. So what I bring to the table is a background on not only the technology of how microwave communication systems work, but also the reality of how consumer devices come to life and how corporations work to build these technologies. So that's what I bring to the table. And as Charles says, I'm here to steer him clear of things that don't make sense and to try and keep sober second thoughts. So through working with Charles over a number of years, I've increasingly learned more and more about EMF and the issue. Like many, many moons ago, I thought everything was safe. In fact, it was my daughter who came to me with a project saying, somebody was telling her that these EMFs weren't safe in schools, and could I look at it for her? And I, very quickly did a cursory survey, like everybody does, and came away saying, no, we've got rules, we've got regulations, everybody's protected, the government is keeping us safe. And then later, when discussing it with Charles, I did a more in-depth review and was really shocked and stunned at what I found, that in fact, the regulations really only pay lip service to science. They're all based on physics, not biology. And that all of the regulatory regimes and agencies are essentially captured with a revolving door through industry. So it really is a caveat emptor, let the buyer beware. And the information is exceedingly hard to come by. And like many industrial powerful industries in the past, whether it be tobacco or oil, there's a lot of vested interest in keeping people happy and comfortable using their devices. But the reality is that there are some really serious questions regarding human safety and a great deal of science to support people being concerned.
Yeah, wow. This conversation is going to be way juicier than I envisioned, because I love the fact that you're an engineer, chemical that is, but you have this. A lot of engineers come to me and, you know, sometimes it's Facebook comments, which is not a place for great discussions. We all know that. But sometimes it's lengthy emails and a lot of very, very angry electrical or electronic engineers that have been, almost, I wouldn't say brainwashed, but it's part of the culture in industry that there's no effect. If you break this idea, it is a very difficult thing for them, I think, to fathom and to juggle with. If there is even a remote possibility that there are health effects, then are we responsible? Are we harming people? I think it's just part of a big psychological game that I see. But on the other hand, I see a lot of engineers, even very high-level IEEE fellows, like James C. Lin, for example, who's also a cancer expert, who turned around and said, you know what, I think that the industry should be held more liable on what they're doing, and it does look like we should urgently follow the precautionary principle. But today's discussion is more like, are the rules being followed in the first place? Which is, we have radiation limits that have been set pretty much everyone listening to that know that they're already all outdated and probably not sufficient for protection. But something happened. I don't know if you gentlemen want to explain, especially to people that are not familiar with it, what is the phone gate? And I think that the lawsuit that you're involved with, Charles, is part of this, but, you know, in Canada. So just dive into, what are the safety regulations around phones and how are they possibly not being followed by industry? And how come we're coming to this understanding now?
Well, actually, I think Pedro is better to explain that than I am. The sad truth is we are not compliant with the regulations, but there are a number of them and they are packaged one way by industry and read another way by the government. But in point of fact, even Safety Code 6 is not met. So there are real problems. Pedro, do you want to talk a bit about that?
Yeah, so as you said, Nicolas, the regulations go back a long way, 30 years. They go back a lot of it. The regulatory framework relies heavily on an organization called ICNIRP, which is a self-selecting organization. They have no government ties. They're an NGO. So they're not incumbent to anyone. And they create these recommendations, which systematically nations around the world, regulators, rely on. Now, these, if one traces them all the way back, relative to sufficiency, they go back to tests, behavioral tests done with like 5 monkeys and 8 rats to find out where does the animal get uncomfortable and show behavioral changes. And based on those small tests, all regulations for use of every phone derive from that. So that's the background a little scientifically. Legislatively, in the US, we have the Federal Communications Commission, which has a dual role. They're in charge of both encouraging the industry and promoting the industry and technology. And on the other hand, they are the sole arbiters of safety. If they say it's safe, it's safe. No one can question them legally. There's no framework to do that. In Canada, it's a little bit different. Because in Canada, the roles are split. We have Health Canada, whose primary role is to keep Canadians safe. All of their regulations are precautionary, preventive. You got to show me it's safe before you can do it. And then on the other hand, we have Industry Canada, whose role is to promote industry and make technologies available for Canadians, right? And so the role of what is safe and what is certified and allowed is split in two. And as Charles was referring to, Safety Code 6 is the guideline from Health Canada defining what is safe. And it says, you know, radiations above a certain level are not considered safe, or rather that there is a limit that we define for exposure for safety. On the other hand, Industry Canada says if you can show by test that your phone, when you use it in this way, does not exceed its safe. But the reality is the way that the phones are tested is not representative of the way phones are used. And so that difference, which seems minor, is huge. For example, the difference between holding a phone here or here can be triple, quadruple, five times as much radiation. And that's enough to toss the needle over the line. So a few years ago, a lot of work was done. You talked about PhoneGate. That was a huge thing. Chicago Tribune did a huge article. They went out in the market, purchased some phones, took them to a certified testing lab that tests devices for companies to get the stamp of approval and allow them to be sold. And they decided to test them in a slightly different way, which is test them how they are used, not how the regulation says you need to test them to get the stamp. And when they did this, they found, lo and behold, the phones that people were being purchasing and using without any further instruction are exceeding what are called the safety limits.
Yeah, and does it have to do just with the distance that is being used between the phone and the head, or that so-called, you know, 5 to 25 millimeters that was used at a certain point, versus the reality is, of course, 0 to 2 millimeters if you have it in the pocket, but mostly 0, let's face it, people. I saw a man just at a coffee shop this morning. I'm in Budapest, and this is true all around the world, who had a phone in his shirt pocket. You know, it's 1 millimeter from his heart. I don't know if that falls within the safety code 6 or whatever ICNIRP standard they have in Budapest, but probably not, right? Probably exceeds it. So is that just because of separation, or is there something else also?
So it's a little more complicated than just separation, but to come back to your analogy, having the phone against the body, specifically around the heart, is one of the most dangerous things that one can do routinely. So businessmen who have a phone in their jacket pocket, or someone who carries a phone in their shirt pocket, this is exceedingly dangerous as an ongoing practice. Quite alarmingly, for example, young women under the age of 40, surveys have shown that about 15% of them carry their phones tucked into their brassiere, directly in contact with the breast. This is an exceedingly dangerous practice, very controversial, but there are many cases of women who have had very bad outcomes in terms of breast cancer. So distance is really important. Below 15 millimeters of separation, you can get an increase of 30% for every millimeter closer. So it's hugely problematic. Now, unfortunately, distance is not the only consideration. You know, if I were to pick up my phone and dial a call and hold it to my ear, the screen goes dark. There's a sensor in the phone that detects when the phone is against the head. And so that sensor actually also tunes down the power of the transmitter when the phone is against the head. But it's not 100% reliable. There are many stories about these things not work. When one does a test, that sensor kicks in. And so the tested values are often not at all representative of what the phone is radiating or can radiate when you're on the call. So, this is the most important factor, but it's not the only one.
Okay, so this is really a question how I see it. And let me know if I'm wrong. It's a question of how things are tested versus how things act in the real world. I came across a lot of different scientific papers. I really look at IEEE these days and their different journals. And I look at EMF studies that are being sent by Joel Moskowitz or other scientists. And some of them are so revealing, it makes me... usually I have a reaction that is mixed. Anger, I laugh, and I'm anxious at the same time. It's a very mixed bag, because in the end I say, oh my God, our use of technology has nothing to do with, or let's say our safety limits have nothing to do with really how phones are used. For example, I came across this set of studies where engineers looked at different situations. People are in a subway train. People are in an elevator shaft. So different shielded environments that they call them, including when you're just underground parking your car, right? Second floor, second underground, and how that exposure is greater than as tested. And basically they concluded, well, we didn't really foresee in our, you know, as if it's impossible to foresee how people are going to use a phone. I mean, it's just stupid, right? But It just says, well, in these situations, which is every day, like most people every day would face that situation, the phones are kind of exceeding what the limit or kind of dangerous for people with pacemakers and different things. They kind of said in between the lines, they cannot do recommendations. They're just, you know, looking at the situation. They're not the kind of medical doctors or regulators, and they're just saying, well, I don't think we should use phones in those situations, which is just ludicrous because everyone does. I've got so many examples, but I could rant on and on and on. But it just seems that there are so many situations where people would exceed the already very obsolete limits, correct?
Yeah.
Go ahead,
Pedro.
Well, what I was going to say is your example about the phone in the elevator, in the subway car, underground, sort of help people understand, you know, we think of our technology as passive, right? We think of a phone as a device. It's dead, it's done. The reality is very different than that. So imagine you're in a quiet cafe and you're speaking with someone across the table. You'll whisper. It's adequate. You can hear yourself. You have a fantastic conversation. Now you're at a cocktail party. It's very loud. What happens? You just raise your voice. You just raise your voice. And so when the phones are tested in the testing chamber, in order to get the piece of paper that allows them to be sold, it's like in the cafe, the phones are whispering. Yeah. But when you're in the subway, when you're underground, the phone's job is to talk to the closest cell tower. It's going to raise its voice.
Yeah.
And when you're driving in a car, a metallic shielded box, not only does it have to speak louder, the phone, to get across the metal box, but if you're on the highway, it's not just talking to one tower, right? Your signal is leapfrogging tower to tower, and your phone, regardless of whether you're on a call, in a conversation or not, is constantly in the background, actively searching out up to 16 different cell phone towers, finding the strongest one and negotiating protocols. So even if your phone is just happily tucked in your shirt pocket and you're doing nothing with it, it's constantly negotiating protocols and emitting radiation or updating your Facebook status or other things. The phone is a very active, very smart device. And the way it's tested in a closed box, in a circumstance, has nothing to do with how the phone behaves on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah.
And so there are important legal implications to what Pedro's just described, and Nick noticed, in particular, what we're calling the defeat device, because our success, and I think the future success of these cases, is under consumer protection claims. So the companies have a duty to fully inform of all risks, a duty to warn of all risks, and duty to tell people how to use their device safely. The phone companies are not doing that. So the defeat device in particular that tunes it down, as Pedro says, is misleading, is deceitful. So the consumer protection laws are very demanding about full disclosure, and in particular with regard to anything that has health implications. So that's where we've had success, and I think we will continue to have success, because the industry does not want to walk down the path of explaining what the problems really are, what safe use would look like, and what risks exist, and they're only talking about non-thermal effects. So we're taking the consumer approach, even though the damages are environmental and considerable, obviously. It's the consumer approach where we've been authorized for punitive damages for failure to properly inform and to warn. And I think that that's the path that will be successful in the future. Other jurisdictions have not taken that approach. You did mention that it's been going on for some time in the States. It's now more than 22 years there have been brain cancer cell litigation. They've had reversal recently. I think that may be problematic for those kinds of claims. But the consumer approach, I think, is where there'll be success.
So in other words, there's a lack of transparency around how the devices are tested versus how they should be used. And please explain a little bit more about the lawsuit in particular. So if I understand correctly, these are people, fellow Quebecers, that decided to, I guess, take the information that they received from, I don't know if it has to do with Citizens for Safe Technology, CS4T, or I don't know exactly who, or just ordinary citizens that decided that this information, I learned that my phone is emitting too much. I'm going to sue a big company. Is it kind of David versus Goliath situation?
It's actually, to tie it back to what you're discussing earlier. So the Cohen case in the United States, which was the one that followed the Chicago Tribune study, which is a version of PhoneGate, quite frankly, right? It's about the testing regimen being false and misleading.
Yes.
We took the California case. We redesigned it for Quebec and for Quebec consumer law and our environmental law. And we added to it the particular claims that Pedro was well aware of concerning the engineering issues and the manner in which the defeat devices work to diminish the use while testing, but not while being operated by the consumer. We put all that together in the context of a consumer claim, and we were authorized on one of our three claims, which was about failure to warn and punitive damages. We were not successful on the issue of making health claims, and that is now before the Court of Appeal. So both Samsung and Apple filed their appeal. We filed an incidental appeal to say we should be authorized also as concerns health claims, not just the matter of false advertising. And the Court of Appeal will hear that in the next 3 or 4 months. As we've been authorized, if that succeeds, we'll then go to the merits of the case and start again with experts and witnesses and discovery of documents. But we're the only case that's been authorized as a class action for EMF ever.
Around the world?
Ever. Anywhere.
Wow.
So they've been doing 22 years in the U.S. of failure. We're the only one.
Do you think this could have wide-ranging implications around the world? I don't know how law works. So if it is successful, does it mean that in Spain they could recuperate the case and say, look, in Canada they did this and that and could start the action again following different laws? Could be in the EU or...
In particular, in the EU, because our Quebec's consumer protection legislation is of European origin, is of French origin for the most part, French and German origin. So the consumer protection laws that we have in Quebec, but it's the same in Ontario and BC, are largely the same, are all modeled on European laws from the 1960s. And they all have a very high degree of duty to inform, duty to warn. They're in favor of the consumer, and they are precautionary in nature. So we were successful by taking that approach. We are trying to create enough presumptive evidence that the duty to prove it's not dangerous falls upon the defendants. So under a consumer protection approach, that can be done. And in my view, it's equally valid all over Europe. I think also in the States, I think the cases in the States could have been better litigated, especially in California, under consumer protection statutes. They've got problem of preemption, but that can be gotten around, in my view. But certainly for Europe, our model would be entirely applicable.
And when you're referring to California, is it specifically about the city of Berkeley and the right to know ordinance, or is this a different one?
Well, that was a huge success, quite frankly, and they did succeed initially as concerns preemption, which is one of the major hurdles. No, I think you would do, I would bring a case like Cohen, a consumer-based class action, but I would allege the fraud. I would allege the collusion with the regulator, and I would show the defeat device. I think with those kinds of things, it's a much more powerful case. And then you need to bring the right experts, people like Pedro. I think we wanted to rely on epidemiology. We think that people like Hardell, Carlberg, Chris Portier, who wanted to be involved in the EMF case but was not in D.C., that's the approach we'll take. But yeah, you're most likely to succeed as a consumer claim relating to failure to warn and the consequent health risks. So the environment comes in as a secondary issue.
Okay. Yeah. So, and also I think consumers themselves, I think the average person cares about the environment, but maybe cares more about not getting cancer for themselves.
Absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely.
So, it's also something that is, I think, quite shocking to the public, where most of the public is, I don't know if it's in the dark or in denial or both about cell phone dangers, but a lot of people, everyone that, you know, is outside my usual circles, I tell them, well, you know, a phone in the pocket might be linked to this about your fertility. Oh my God, they're completely shocked. Like it's something, I just announced that aliens came to planet Earth. I mean, it's... it's something very bizarre for them. So I think this could bring major awareness to the public as far as, wait a minute, maybe we should be a little bit cautious about these things.
Well, we're working now on zero millimeter claims. I think the pocket is a much stronger claim. In particular, as a result of our lawsuit, we were contacted by people who had correlated breast cancer to having the phone in the bra. That's wow. zero millimeters.
Yep.
And our calculation is there's in the vicinity of 800 Quebecers that would have gotten breast cancer as a result of carrying the phone in the bra. So those kinds of claims at zero millimeters are going to be very hard for the defendants to disprove. They haven't war gamed it. There's nothing at all in the way of warnings in their manuals or elsewhere. They actually advertise showing phones in bras in close proximity. So we think that that's the way to go is zero millimeters, and not even waste the time with the how far do you hold your phone from the head. So those kinds of claims, in my view, those kinds of claims are stronger. Pocket, breast pocket, in the bra.
Because yeah, and I saw these case studies. I'll link to one study in particular. It's John J. West from California who had this I don't know the name of the study by heart. My God, like multifocal breast cancer something.
That's right.
So I just I just have this library of studies in my head, but I'm gonna find it. It is a few years ago, but you see that in those cases, right? This is just a few cases, but still, it's very hard to deny when you have multiple small tumors that are in a quadrant of the breast that is quite unusual, as explained in the study. So normally you get breast cancer on this side, but now it's on the other side. So first, it's kind of the first degree of evidence that something is amiss, but also it kind of almost shapes like a phone, right? So it's very hard.
When you can see the phone in the tumor, you've got a prima facie case. But that's exactly how you would make a presumptive evidence claim, right? You'd say, look, I've got testimony that the phone was carried for a long period of time in this location. The cancer's here. The shape's there. Prove to me it's not true. Make the defendants make the case as opposed to you having to make.
Yeah. And then what about the fact that I guess something that could be presented to court is also how ludicrous it is that it's difficult to find the information under RF and settings and all this, and even it changes every update, right? So that's something that Deborah Davis from the Environmental Health Trust has been saying for years. That's something I learned from her book, Disconnect.
Yep.
They say, okay, well, you know, that device, in order to comply with FCC or Safety Code 6, it should be 15 millimeters away from the body. But as you alluded to a few seconds ago, then you see an ad and they have a phone right next to it. So the ad doesn't follow the rules. And yet in the phone, it says, so it's all a game of how these things could be used. And it even goes much further than phones also. And I don't know if that's too much of a digression, but I heard about, you know, Alexa or Amazon Echo or these machines. It says 1 foot from the device to follow the FCC standards. Who does that? Sometimes it's very near a kid. Maybe someone hugs it. I don't know. Like, even for it just does not make sense, these things, especially since consumers are under the impression that everything is safe and they're not gonna modify their behavior to make it float. Right? So
It is about the warnings, you're right. And the important thing from our point of view, and I think it applies not just in Quebec but elsewhere, is that where there are health risks, the duty to inform becomes much higher. The duty to warn is raised by the level of risk, and you have to not only tell people what the risk is but how to avoid it. For certain, that's for all of Canada. I would think it'd be the same in Europe, but you know, the higher the risk, the higher the duty.
So do you foresee that manufacturers, and I don't know, maybe that's, I don't know if you want to play futuristic games here, but do you think, I saw good papers by the International Commission on the Biological Effects of EMFs, ICPE, that came out with a good paper with Dr. Paul Heroux and colleagues about what could be done to cell phones to make them safer. Some of it is quite simple, right? It's reducing emissions when it's very close to the body, or making them, you know, disappear, shielding the antenna, these kind of solutions. Are we moving towards big lawsuits and company kind of saying, I think we should make these things safer? Deborah Davis often talks about, you know, the seatbelt example. Are we moving towards an industry with gadgets where you foresee, okay, we're going to start putting, you know, safety features in place because clearly we're doing it wrong in the moment?
We have asked for that in our proceedings. We've got a number of various injunctive types of relief. Some of them are to warn, like the Berkeley ordinance, to warn at the point of sale. Others are to retrofit the equipment themselves. We also have asked the level of transmissions be diminished, but Pedro should speak to that more in more detail. But these things are already being sought in our lawsuit.
Wow. Perfect.
Yeah, so I mean, the challenges are there's different aspects and different ways of looking at this. So as a regulator, you're either trying to encourage industry and promote, you know, making it accessible to citizens because there are benefits to technologies, obviously, and we'll have to have access. You need to regulate them. And you need to have a mechanism to make that happen. On the other hand, you need to protect the public. Then we have, how do I test these things? So you have these good, these engineers who are challenged with how can I reproducibly create this testing regimen so I can systematically regulate phones for health. So necessarily that's a reducing exercise. So the engineers in good faith with the information they're given are being told, how can I test this phone to get a result? You know, I need a machine that I can put the phone in and get a result out. It passes, it fails, right? And then there's the companies. And the companies, let's be honest, we've got tons of examples. Companies are about making money, whatever else they say publicly, right? We all remember what happened. Well, some of us remember what happened in tobacco, but during the tobacco time, the whole marketing campaign, literally the slogan was, our product is down, right? And so it's not about, is the science real? Is the science false? It's about, what can we get away with? What can we get the public to believe, right? And the company is never going to do anything unless they are regulated. You talked about seatbelts. The automotive industry has been exceedingly successful in driving down and putting a brake on regulation that requires either better safety, better fuel consumption, reduced emissions, etc. We all know what happened with Volkswagen. The airbag did not come about because it was regulated and regulators said you need to make your car safe and put in airbags. The airbag came about because consumers asked for it and one automaker took the risk of putting it in. And then when everybody loved it, it became a competitive advantage and they had to. So change will only happen if either A, regulators impose the requirement, or B, consumers speak out. Now, regulators can't impose requirements if they have no teeth and if there's a revolving door to industry. And consumers cannot speak out if they believe they are safe and don't know there's an issue. So it's all about the campaign, public information.
Wow, that's it's really, I think, for me, you know, a very important discussion, because it's been years that I've been sitting with these thoughts, talking to a few colleagues, and we were talking back in 2017 when I wrote my book about, okay, well, how will this thing happen? And my best guess was litigation, which leads to consumer awareness, which leads to safer technologies, and that's how I foresaw it. And of course, we could, you know, go on and on about this. It's not just the phones going to be, then the routers and the different machines. It's a huge deal. It's going to take decades to sort out. But as a whole, I think that the phone example, as something that might be one of the riskier examples we have, I think it might get people interested in the fact that at least the microwave radiation is not completely safe. It's not something that your body ignores, which is pretty much what a lot of people still try to argue about these days. I don't know if you want to comment on that. And then I'd like to just touch, maybe as a closing thought, on Bluetooth devices, because I don't know what's happening about that, but I have a few thoughts, and I'm really wondering if someone is, I don't know if there's going to be litigation about those, because I don't know if we have any examples of the emissions and whatnot, but what do you want to comment on my first thought?
Pedro, you want to do that, or?
Yeah, can you just remind me what your first thought was?
Yeah, no problem. No problem. I was just rambling. Let's go to Bluetooth.
All right.
My thought with Bluetooth is this. We have litigation now that is, well, hopefully going to eventually lead to people recognizing that phones are dangerous very close to the body. But now we're selling more and more of these headphones, or other wearables very close to the body, although at lower power, but very close to the body, and some of them are inside the ear. So
yeah.
Is there testing around Bluetooth devices? I don't see a lot of those. Is there the same exercise that's been done with phone and phone gate? Is someone trying to do it with Bluetooth? Because I think we might be missing an entire category of products here.
Yeah, so these are all excellent questions. And for sure, you know, electromagnetic radiation, even microwave radiation, it is a spectrum. There's lots of different types. Distance is a key consideration. So, you know, your router that's across the room is at least a foot away from you. It's regulated in a certain way. It's tested in a certain way. And there's a certain exposure protocol, including how to test it. Cell phones are the most obvious target because, A, people are carrying them on their person.
Yeah.
People are using them increasingly. Like, every study of cell phone safety, every study ever done, shows that there is a risk, specifically with regards to cancer, but others as well, that there is a risk, and that risk increases with the duration and frequency of use. Even the studies that industry rely on that say it's safe, when you read the details of the studies, they show that for people, quote-unquote, heavy users have a higher risk of cancer. What's a heavy user? When these studies were done, a heavy user was someone who used their phone more than one half of an hour per day for a 10-year period. That's the definition of a heavy user in these studies that the industry is saying, look, it's safe. Today, people carry their phones under their pillow, in their bed. They stream music over Wi-Fi to go to sleep. I mean, we're in a completely different use case. That's why the cell phone is the nearest term. That and because 95% of adult Americans have a cell phone, right? There are more active cell phone subscriptions on the planet right now than there are human beings on the planet right now. That's why cell phones are the most obvious start. Now, Bluetooth devices do have much lower transmission powers because they're transmitting locally. The Bluetooth device is talking to your phone, the Bluetooth device is talking to the speaker, the Bluetooth device is talking to the computer, whereas your cell phone is talking to a cell tower a kilometer away, not in the city, but could be. And so yes, the power is lower, but the distance, right? I've got a radio transmitter in my ear, literally inside my head. It is not safe. But when we look at the relative risks and dangers, right, in terms of the number of users as a percentage of population or sheer numbers, and the duration of use, right, it's less. So it's an important conversation. It's a critical conversation. Lower power does not mean safe. You know, industry is always talking about these are very low power transmitters. They're very low power compared to maybe hydropoles. But when we look at the background microwave radiation historically that the human being evolved in, we're 18 orders of magnitude above. And the background in cities is constantly, the noise is increasing, right? Like we were talking before about whispers. The louder the noise gets in the room, the louder these devices have to speak.
Yeah.
And then the advent of 5G and the proliferation of antennas, it's just getting louder and noisier to the point where, you know, there are an increasing number of people, hypersensitive individuals, who are saying, help, you know, I can't live.
Yeah, totally. And I guess Bluetooth will come next. It's especially popular in the younger generation, even younger than me or millennials like me. I see, for sure, some people will use it, you know, to replace their cell phone, but it's at certain use cases where they're in business and a lot of people still use the phone, but obviously, I see how the phone is the bigger problem. And I hope that eventually the rules themselves are going to be looked at, which is, you know, another conversations. Now we're arguing about what is there and whether it's being followed or not. But if what is there as far as EMF regulation limits, whether it's ICNIRP or Health Canada or the FCC, once this is shattered, it leaves us with, okay, well, what's next? And can the industry really follow these guidelines? It's going to be a long story, but
the lawsuit that compelled the FCC to reconsider their rules was very well considered and could have an effect. Now, the FCC hasn't acted yet, and maybe somebody should give them a push to do so. But that was I think, the smartest litigation and the most successful, other than the Berkeley Ordinance, so far in the U.S. And that'll be a very interesting outcome. It's been too long, but I think that's a winner.
Yeah, I can agree with you more. And I'll put links to that, to the ordinance, and also to the win. It was a combined case of the Environmental Health Trust and Children's Health Defense that got litigated together. That was a historic win in, you know, November of 2021, something like that. And I'm still waiting. Right. I'm not holding my breath too much, because I know it's going to be a long time. But lately, I came across, you know, activists that were discussing the cases, and they're trying to get things moving. And I think that the judges that were on the case, or some, I heard that, you know, the law is getting impatient a little bit towards the FCC, because they're, as they should, because they're not doing anything at the moment, or they seem to be kind of stalling what's happening.
it's an order of the court. You have to act, right?
Exactly. Or you're supposed to. So they're trying to avoid their responsibilities here. But it's not, It's not like anyone is surprised, I guess, but I think it's gonna eventually have some breakthrough. I don't want to take more of your time. You know, it's been so helpful for me to understand what's happening here with this case. I am personally excited, but I want to know, everyone that is listening to this, whether it's more locally in Montreal or in Canada or around the world, how can they learn more about this case or follow, especially if they're, you know, Canadian consumers that might be eligible to this class action? Or how can people learn more about it or support your work? And that's for you individually, or are there certain organizations that you work with? Because part of my mission is also getting these organizations and the individuals' work known more widely.
Well, for people that want to actually see the legal proceedings, there's a Quebec class action registry. And if you go to the registry and you type in Ariel, Tracy Ariel, A-R-I-A-L, that's the lead plaintiff, you'll find the case against Apple and Samsung. There's a website for Safe EMF, which describes what that group does. And they can also contribute there to that group. And we're also interested in having contacts with people that have had health effects, in particular, if it has to do with breast cancer and holding the cell phone in the bra, and they can contact me via my email, bluegreenlaw@gmail.com.
Okay. And are you too busy, or do you want me to put that email under the YouTube video?
I don't know how dangerous that would be.
I don't know. Hopefully there won't be 100,000 people listening to this. It's more like 1 or 2,000. But
of course, we already get a lot of email, but some more would be nice. Sure, why not?
Okay, well, especially please, if you know someone or you suspect that yourself might have developed a tumor with your phone, whether it's a brain tumor or breast tumor or other places where you put a phone for several hours, heart. I know there's parotid gland, thyroid. I saw some studies on that, but also, and I personally have been very concerned about phone in the pocket and the tumors, the increase in tumors of the groin area, including, you know, prostate, testicular, ovarian, colon cancer. All of them are increasing in our youth, and who knows if it has a link, but it is very likely that there is a link, considering it looks like it increases the risk of cancers in other places. So it's just logically speaking, I think that if you suspect that, please write to Charles O'Brien. And I know that this is also something that other groups of attorneys, such as bbilan.org, are looking at. They're trying to get, you know, cases to present. So also in the U.S., I'll put a link underneath the video also. If people, you know, I think that you deserve justice, and at least, you know, participating in that is very important, because if attorneys don't have these cases, things are not moving as rapidly as if there's all these cases where we can show causality. So thanks so much. I don't know if you have any parting words, anything you wanted to say or conclude that we didn't address before we go.
No, thank you for having us. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much, Charles. And thank you so much, Pedro. And I hope that we can stay in touch and learn more as this case moves forward.
Fantastic. Take care.
Thank you.